So I want to know as well, because I've been a publisher ages ago, 20 years ago. I've kicked it. I'm on stages now. And I know that it's very challenging to be a publisher. And I know that these guys who are backstage, they are the big rock stars of the publishing industry, and that's why we have them here. But obviously they're also challenging in challenging times, because they need to focus on revenues, they need to fight for clicks, they need to fight against business models that are coming up, but also against those big guns like Facebook and Google. And obviously also there's influencers out there who are challenging their business, who want to grab some of the budgets from the media world, and they're also a challenger of their business model in the publishing world. But these guys have the right strategies, and I'm gonna bring them up on stage now for you, so you know who's gonna speak to you in a second. So first of all, we've got the CEO at BBC News, Jim Egan. Come on, make some noise. Yeah, that's good, much better. Jim, hello. Then we've got the Vice President, Global Publishers and Platforms at Outbrain, Stephanie Himoff. Come on, Stephanie. Good to see you again. Then we've got a Senior Vice President, Global Agency Partnerships at the Wall Street Journal's Barron's Group, Josh Rucci. And then we've got the Commercial Director at CNN, Pippa, Scaife. And the CEO of Upday, Peter Würtenberger. And last but not least, your moderator, who is the director of media authorities, of German media authorities, Tobias Schmid. Welcome on stage. What a great panel of publishers. Good luck.
Thanks to you. Hello, everybody. Fantastic to be here. Yes, as you've heard, my name is Tobias Schmid. I have the honor and pleasure to moderate this fantastic panel. And thanks a lot that someone took over the introduction, because as we have only 30 minutes and five such interesting panelists, I think we shouldn't waste any time. To have 30 minutes for a topic like that with this panelists and to ask a regulator to take over the moderation is an interesting idea, and we will see what we can make out of it. So, first of all, welcome to all of you. It's fantastic to have you here, and I would like immediately to start, and I would like to start with you, Josh. The organizers asked us to discuss about the question, how are you doing, publishers? So I would like to ask you the simple question, publishers, what means that?
Yes. Yes.
In the moment we have.
We are a dyed-in-the-wool publisher. We've been a publisher for 130 years at Wall Street Journal and Barron's. We have 3.3 million subscribers globally who pay us money each month as a publisher. And we publish up to both B2C platforms through a consumer platform like the Wall Street Journal, as well as B2B platforms, primarily through a product called Factiva. We consider ourselves publisher because people trust us to make decisions. And as such, we consider ourselves a decision platform, to where the global C-suite, which we have an 81% share of globally, look to us on a day-by-day basis, whether they're looking at us as consumers or as business people, to make decisions. And that's how we generally define ourselves.
OK, thanks. I think to describe what is a publisher is, for a house like yours, almost easy. Could be also easy for BBC, I don't know. That's your perspective of this question. What is your character as publisher for BBC, Jim?
Yeah, so at the BBC, we have a slightly schizophrenic business model, because I think, as most people know, within the UK, we are publicly funded through a household license fee. Outside the UK, we are solely commercially funded. So I run the BBC World News TV network and the BBC.com digital properties. And of course, just like Josh, we think of ourselves as long-established publishers upholding traditional but still highly relevant values in journalism. And for us, that means the combination of the content creation through our news-gathering activities, the editorial exercise of curation and presentation, the presentation of all of those in the form of a brand that we take very seriously, and we think protection of that brand is really important. And I suppose what we're going to be talking about today is how you defend that brand, but also project it as the distribution question changes in the world that we now live in.
I think this is really an interesting aspect that you say one of the key facts that drives your business is the brand and trust into brand. And as far as I've read also about your work, Pippa, that's almost also the same story that you would tell us from CNN perspective. Is it the brand and the content that drives your business as publisher, or how would you describe that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very similar, not to sound too much like a broken record, but we definitely think of ourselves as a publisher who has built a brand and a kind of storytelling voice very much around that idea of trust and reliability and, I think, factfulness. We've been in the news space for coming up to 40 years, and we were really created with all of those things in mind and have kind of built our heritage of a brand with that at the forefront. But we probably think about publishing in a slightly broader way, because within CNN, we also have other publishing platforms like Great Big Story, which is something that I work across on a daily basis, which is outside of the news space and is much more about capturing the idea of purpose and emotion within the same authentic storytelling.
Okay, see. That leads us to Peter, and I say it with a little break, because I think now we changed a little bit the color of commands. And as far as I understand your business model, the first question, of course, is, are you a publisher? I'm not sure if I understand it correctly. And the second is, as far as I've read your commands, the idea of your business model is not so much that the brand of a publisher drives the business, but more the behavior of consumers. Is it right?
Yeah, well, when I was invited to this panel of publishers, I thought, wow, what an honor to sit next to those icons of like 40 years of publishing. This is great. And we are sort of like partially disrupting the publishing business, because by now we are by far the leading European news app with more than 25 million unique users. But at the same time, we are helping the publishers, because we aggregate their content and distribute them to our users. And what we don't do, what Facebook Insert Articles did, we don't sort of take away the users from your site, we distribute to your site. So it's a sort of mixed model, as you say. And actually today we have announced that we go beyond Samsung in the future. So we're going to launch a brand with the name of Early. So first we launch Early Audio. It's a podcast aggregator, new business, important business, as you guys know. And second, there will be Early News, which is the aggregator aside from the Samsung ecosystem. So we are looking forward to this.
Congratulations.
Okay, interesting to hear. And do you say, what do you say? Are you a publisher? No, you're supporting publishers.
Well, we employ more than 50 editors across Europe. So I would say yes. In each of the 16 countries we are active in, we have journalists to aggregate, to curate the top news. But technically spoken, we are an aggregator, because we aggregate more than 4,000 different media brands across Europe. So we are really a mixture of both.
Leads us to Stephanie and the question, Outbrain, where is your role in this value chain? What is your role in this under the line of publishing?
So just a quick note, I was equally as excited as Peter to be invited to this panel, as we have the great pleasure of working with every single one of the great brands, media brands, and platform here. So the role that we have, I mean, we power the discovery feed experience of the open web. We reach 1.2 billion uniques every month, and we provide meaningful and relevant discovery experiences. So our role is to really support the publishing industry in terms of ensuring that, you know, we drive through engagement through native advertising, that we allow publishers to fight the duopoly by giving them more control over the distribution. It's something that we're very committed to. In the last 2 years, we put more than $2 billion back into the publishing industry.
I see it. This first round leads me to a following question, especially to the three of you. They are a bit closer to the term of publishing. And again, I would like to start with Wall Street Journal, as you have this impressive tendency of a real relation to your readers, so to say, or consumers. Mm-hmm. What is your reaction if you hear that? Is it also your point of view that at the end the behavior of consumer is the relevant factor, or is it more the perspective of first producing a journalistic product and then bring it to the market? So,
yes, the reader has become the centerpiece of what we do, right? And the primary reason for that is relatively straightforward. The majority of our revenue today within the Wall Street Journal and Dow Jones comes from readers. It does not come from advertisers. So that's one piece of it, to where inevitably readers are going to win the day across the board. The other part of it is that as we have had a proliferation of other platforms, as there has been brand safety issues as well, we become more of a trusted platform based on the data integrity that we can provide from logged in, authenticated, paid users. So with that, we now have a unification, if you will, or a rallying around a single point, both from our newsrooms who are trying to serve the reader, educate the reader, provide context for the reader's decisions, from the commercial teams that are trying to drive our subscriptions, and increasingly from our advertising teams. Because without the reader and without the trust of the reader, none of those things can function correctly. Mm-hmm. So I would say at the end of the day, the reader is number one, number two, and number three for the main parts of our business.
For the BBC, as of course the classical broadcasting business is not so much used by this idea of subscribers, especially if you have this double structure like BBC has, what is your perspective to this change of refinancing structure that we are talking about?
Yeah, I think Josh raises a very good point, which is that shift which many of our peers in the industry have gone through towards being focused on subscription revenues really makes a publisher much more like a retail business, with that sort of primacy of customer orientation and that direct relationship with the user. The BBC is not in that space right now, as you say. So we are generally thinking about advertiser-funded monetization of what we do. That is extremely important to us. I think we consider ourselves to be most trusted editorially. We also talk about being most trusted commercially, so a sort of prudent approach that we've been taking over many years by electing not to do things like carrying political advertising actually turned out to be quite a good decision in light of recent events and so on. So we think about that commercial trustworthiness alongside our editorial trustworthiness. That makes us cautious in some areas, but I think that caution leads to a brand reputation that in the long term is to our commercial advantage.
I'm wondering if, just as a short opinion from your side, do you think that the tendency to going more and more into the subscriber business from a lot of content companies, could this have a kind of negative influence to the question of independency of especially journalistic content?
I don't think moving to a subscriber-based model is a direct threat to independence. I think that the question of editorial independence is something which is, you know, really at the center of all of these brand identities that we're talking about and that we want to promote. I think those questions of independence also come up in one's distribution relationships. So it's very easy and popular to trash Facebook and Google and portray them as the enemies of the publishing industry. I actually don't take that view. We have some quite good relationships, although they're not entirely straightforward relationships with those organizations. But thinking about your independence, how your brand is going to be projected, what the attribution is, those things are all important, both in quite long established relationships that we have and also with some of the newer ones. So today we're really excited to announce that we've been appointed as Quibi's international news provider. So Quibi's a new made for mobile short form video platform. We're working with them, and one of the things we are thinking about as we produce our daily Global Essentials show is how do we project and retain the essence of the BBC and our own editorial independence on a third party platform.
If okay, I could jump in on that, Tobias, as well. Yeah. We just did a research study with Havas, about 5,500 of our readers and of news consumers globally. 50% of those were in Europe, 500 were in Germany as part of that. Interestingly, I think readers help to keep us honest when it comes to maintaining independence within our newsroom. What they came back with was that only 2% said that matching the opinion that they have versus what's reported would lead to an increase or a decrease in trust, right? So basically 98% said, I'm not particularly interested in what you're in how this article makes me feel necessarily, right? But if you're speaking the truth and you're helping me make decisions, it doesn't matter what my opinions are. That's what the most important thing it is. So interestingly, even though we are a reader-centered business, a reader-centric business right now, it helps to keep us all honest as well in terms of calling balls and strikes, to use a terrible American phrase, properly within our newsroom.
Okay. I would like to quickly get focused on another aspect I'm thinking after your first statements, and maybe I ask you, Pippa, isn't it in conflict in between two general ideas? If you say on the one hand, it is the brand, the trust in the brand, the value of trust you have in a brand like CNN on the one hand, and the things Peter is doing by disaggregating content more or less, by this, Spotify idea we bring only the snippets to the consumers. Do you see a conflict in that, or is this, of course, at the end, it is like it is, but I think this strategy that I hear from all three of you to be very concentrated on the value of your brands, and I think this is you have strong brands, seems to be a little bit conflicting with this idea of disaggregation.
I mean, I think by decentralizing your content and your consumer base, there are challenges that you find yourselves facing as a business. I would also say that it comes with huge benefits. You know, we're at a really exciting time at the moment because we are able to tell our stories in a million different ways for a million different platforms and meet consumers where they want to read and engage with our content. And that offers us, obviously, exciting new ways to diversify our revenue streams. We have to be cognizant as businesses, obviously, about who it is that we're partnering with, and making sure that the trust that we've established with our audiences who are coming to us directly can still be established in those environments. So I think, you know, I wouldn't say that we're in a period at the moment where CNN or most publishers in our space would be entirely comfortable with saying, take our content, let it live everywhere, let it live anywhere. But we are in a position where it makes sense for us as a brand and for our audience as readers and consumers for us to be establishing those relationships where we can ensure that trust exists in other ways.
I see the need of reaction, obviously, and...
what I wanted to add is obviously we're putting a lot of focus into the readers. And we know that there is a all-time low trust, not necessarily in the news content, but in the format. So I think it's probably fair to say, that in the publishing industry, the last 10 years, we have been pushing interruptive form of advertising and irrelevant advertising, which we know is creating the trust issue. We recently did in the UK a survey that shows that 95% of all consumers are more likely to have a negative connotation towards a brand if the brand is interrupting them during their content consumption. And therefore, but on the flip side, they're more likely to trust, to engage, and to transact with a brand that creates a meaningful experience. So I think when we put the reader first, it's very important from a news perspective, but also from the advertising environment. And we provide a native, everything that our technology is backed by native advertising. And we've got great formats that really helps capturing in a very native, non-interruptive way the attention of the readers, really helping them taking action that will ultimately drive better return on ad spend to the marketeers, but in a way that is not interruptive, in a way that is, and I think that's very important. When we think of trust from obviously the content perspective, but also the overall environment that we provide and the advertising experience. And last point is, advertising is only annoying up to the point it becomes interesting. So I think we all have to work harder.
Okay. Peter, you would like to add something?
I would like to build on this. The newspaper industry has been disrupted like hell in the last 20 years, actually. And 20 years ago, everybody said, content is king. We really concentrated on content, on the brand, because the internet was so new when we all brought just for free our content to the web. Then, like 10 years ago, it changed a bit. It was more like distribution is king. Mm-hmm. Facebook came into the picture. We all jumped onto Facebook instant articles and lost a little bit of control of our content. Now, what's happening right now, I think it's reconsidering content, brands, trust. This is the phase we are in right now. So it's a very interesting development of changing between distribution and trust in the brand. So the parts are more on this side again. And we, as a content aggregating company, we regard ourselves more like, you know, where is the user? What does the user want? So I build on what you said on the first sentence.
Yeah.
What is the information the user really wants to know? But we pair it with a journalistic team, which makes sure that the user gets the information that he really needs to know. Mm-hmm. So this combination is key.
So I think
yeah.
Peter is basically right, okay? We were trying to oversimplify over the last two decades by saying it's either content or distribution that's king. Mm-hmm. You know, the answer, which is annoyingly complicated, is you've got to get both of them right, okay? But that doesn't mean that third-party distribution per se is a bad idea. I think it's a bad idea if the impact on your own distribution and your own on-platform audience is very serious. It's a bad idea if you're monetizing it much less well off-platform than you are on-platform, and it's also a bad idea if it's undermining your brand and your brand values. And the problem is that all too often, all three of those things are happening, right? That we're cannibalizing our audiences, the monetization is terrible, and it's also ruining our brand. And that's, to a degree, that may be for the regulators and the policymakers to figure out, but it's also, you know, we can't be pathetic about this. We've got to own our own strategies, right? And make choices about what is in the long-term interest of our business.
You would like to react?
Yes, and also I think we need to understand why, you know, the duopoly has taken control over some of the content. The way content is being consumed is because of the format. I think, you know, users are expecting a mobile-first, personalized feed of discovery. That's the attraction in terms of how they consume content on social network. So I think the great opportunity for all of us working, you know, as publisher or supporting the publishing industry is to replicate this experience and this very native experience into your own properties. Providing a discovery, turning every single page into a discovery stream and interactive. I think it's also, you know, there's a lot to be learned about the interaction that users are, you know, familiar with in social network, and there's no reason why publishing and content creator could not take that, and there's something company like ours who can help with you know, making, turning this, the engagement and making sure that you drive more engagement and feed-based interaction onto your own properties.
May I ask an additional question in this direction? When I'm listening to you, then I agree especially to the concerns I've heard, and I would like to make a little spotlight on that, because here we have one of the most famous and established news brands, well, the Wall Street Journal, BBC, and CNN. So if we would ask three other brands, I don't know, a radio station from North Rhine-Westphalia, a little newspaper, or a smaller station, where you do not have the choice in between establishing your brand on the one hand and getting a kind of support by the mechanisms, don't you think that there is a risk that at the end this is, that something will change from a very, so to say, pluralistic reality we have at the moment into a reduction of pluralism, because at the end the combination of strong brands on the one hand and all these mechanisms leads to supporting the strongers? Do you see there any risk?
You ask me?
Why not?
Yeah, well, the user is, finally, the user decides, you know? And the publishing business, not so much the TV business, it's happening right now, but the publishing business was relying a lot on distribution like 30 years ago. The newspaper was delivered to the house. But everybody in the publishing business thought it was only about the brand and it was only about the content. But in fact, in the US, the news publishing business was able to deliver to every household. Same in Germany.
It's beautiful.
So that was beautiful times. Now the user is in charge. The competitor, our competitor, your competitor, is only one click away. No costs to go from A to B. So it will depend much more on the user. So I think by aggregating it, by making even for smaller brands it possible to get new audience, it's easier for them to do it right now.
Pippa?
Well, it's an interesting point that you raise, because we're talking about competition in a lot of ways. I mean, I think this is what your business is trying to solve. We're talking about competition in a lot of ways in the same way that we were 10, 15 years ago, where you bought the same newspaper every day, you watched the same channel for your 9 o'clock news show, you had the same radio station on in your journey to work. And it just isn't a zero-sum game in the same way that it was 15 years ago. We don't need to be competing in that same way with the assumption that you are loyal to one news brand and one news brand only. You know, I consume all three of our outputs on a weekly basis, sometimes on a daily basis, and that just wouldn't have happened 10 years ago. So we are talking about this kind of heightened competition, but I see that competition as a really positive thing, because we couldn't possibly have been looking at our brands in the same space for the same consumer before this kind of digital revolution happened. So I, on a personal level, really embrace services like yours, where we have this opportunity to aggregate and to really understand why we go to different brands for different reasons at different points in our media consumption journey.
And if you can create unique experiences on third-party platforms to reach a new audience, go for it, right? I mean, we just did a new, we have two big new partnerships, one with Twitter, where we've got a daily video product, which is unique to Twitter. It's published natively on Twitter, which will help us to reach a new audience. Similarly speaking, we did something with Spotify, where we've got a daily podcast on Spotify. Again, unique to Spotify. It does not take anything away from those who subscribe to the Wall Street Journal and have their own authenticated login to the Wall Street Journal and pay us $43 US per month. But it provides a additive experience on another platform, because what we found has not worked, I think, across the board, is just using your same content and publishing it elsewhere on a social platform. The reader doesn't trust it as much. The monetization has not been terrific. But if you can find a unique experience to be additive, then, and which is not easy to do, and it takes investment, but it's something that we do believe in and that we as publishers should be strategic toward in order to survive and thrive.
And I think the great trend, right, is the use of technology as well, to your point that you can use personalization, going to, like, you know, very personalized experience. The ability to know that we can use technology to understand individual preferences in terms of content consumptions allows you to provide on your site or on a third-party platform a very personalized experience, which is what ultimately is going to drive engagement and retention.
Fundamentally, I think there are grounds for optimism. We don't have a demand problem in the news industry.
Okay,
right?
Yeah.
That's correct.
News is in more demand than it ever has been before. So we have a supply side execution problem. It's definitely been a difficult decade. I think we were chasing clicks and clickbait for too long. I think there were some trashy monetization solutions, but things are sorting themselves out. Brand safety is becoming more and more important. People are taking it seriously, and that's in our commercial interest, and it's in the audience interest.
Okay, as life is, 30 minutes are not so long, so that's why I would like to ask you one last quick question after I've heard all the impressive things you've told me. If you would have to change with one of your colleagues, on which seat you would go?
I would go to CNN because they are just great. You know, my personal experience with CNN is I'm an absolute fan of Anderson Cooper. I can't never watch him because he's at 2 p.m. in the night in Europe. I can't watch him. So what do I do? The next morning when I drive to my job, I listen it on my podcast. So those guys, they come from TV, but they have a lot of audio in TV. They just go on the podcast. And in future, you will find it on early audio, okay?
Thank you very much.
Pippa, what would be your choice?
I feel as though I'm obliged to reciprocate, but I'm actually going to say I would go to the BBC just because it's the brand that, you know, I grew up with and that I just see as being such a consistent presence in my life and genuinely has always maintained that quality that I hope CNN strives for as well.
Well, that's
funny.
you can't possibly ask me to choose which one of my customer of Sophie's choice here. I think the what I will want to say is I'm happy to be sitting where I am and be able to support those amazing brands. I think that quality journalism is something that in today's world is needed more than ever before. And I'm very proud to be working for a company that's helping funding quality journalism. So
I might change seats with you, Tobias. It's a job for life, right? Oh, man, everyone likes the idea of that.
I'm hugely impressed with each of these organizations, and I'm a big believer in global scale and the importance of bringing trusted journalism around the world for the good of the world and the good of business. But I've been incredibly impressed with what Axel Springer has done. And going from being primarily a publisher within two countries to having a footprint in several countries around the world, including the largest English-speaking markets. So kudos, and I would be very interested to learn more about Axel Springer as well in terms of how to properly execute global expansion.
Excellent. So I can tell you, being a regulator is not the worst choice you could do. But so now, thanks to you, thanks to Stephanie, to Pippa, Josh, Jim, and Peter for the very interesting and inspiring discussion. Thanks for having me for being here. And to all of you, thanks for listening. Bye.
And thanks to our moderation.